I am Jerry Holkins, and I have the great pleasure to be with Teresa Duringer of Temple Gates. And we're gonna talk all about your Ascension VR stuff. Something that you did, oh man, this is wild. Okay, so you have to understand, I typically like to load it up the first time when I'm with the person who made it. And some of your choices for the cards, like how you've laid it out, are so interesting. Like, usually people, when they try to do a tabletop game, they get obsessed with like the table metaphor. And so they lay everything out flat. But you actually have it like laid out flat in space in front of the person. And then you're looking at the person you're dueling against across the way. This would never even have occurred to me. I would have just done it like the, I would have tried to make it in an inn or a tavern or something, right?
Yeah, well, we started with the table metaphor, just like you said.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, the thing is, in VR right now, there's some like, you know, some tech issues that are still evolving. And right now, text can be kind of notoriously difficult to read, especially at a smaller font size. So having everything down on a table really kind of obscures the view just because of the angle relative to the camera, the first
Absolutely.
Person camera.
Absolutely. I would say that would be the thing that would make something like that fail right away.
Yeah. And really, if you think about every time you play a board game around a table, one person has this like, you know, optimal seat where they can see everything and everyone else is kind of looking at an angle or looking upside down, trying to read upside down. So
right.
The cool thing about the vertical zones that we made is that everyone has the optimal view. You can always see the cards. Yeah,
it's perfect. It's really, really interesting. So let's put all those out. And right now, the current, obviously, Ascension, you know, stands astride the Earth. There's like a million different Ascensions now. And the Ascension VR is the first box, but just for now, right?
Yeah. I've started coding the logic for the expansions. I've already started working on pretty much all the expansions in a lot of the promo packs because I am obsessed with this game and I can't wait to play with all the stuff. But for now, this has just released with the Chronicles of the Godslayer set, and it's the third edition art. And we'll be rolling out expansions as soon as we can get them done.
See, no, I don't want to end my turn. Oh, I see. I'm gonna get a void initiate. That's the thin decking, right?
Yes.
You get those. You get those out there to make it so that you can shave down your stuff and draw things that you actually like.
Mm-hmm. That Arbiter of the Precipice over on the right. That's just my favorite card. It's so good.
Let's zoom in. Let's zoom in on the Arbiter of the Precipice. I'm a fan of Precipi myself. So, this is great.
And the nice thing is, you're playing on the Vive. You've got that positional tracking on your head, so you can actually.
Yeah.
Move your head closer and really. Like,
oh yeah, I mean, I can actually like get up close and examine the card. So this is the legibility. So on a, I was really impressed. So you got Gear, Oculus, and Vive. So, but they're all interoperable.
Yeah. So we have cross-platform multiplayer between Gear, Vive, and Rift, and that was important because we just didn't want to have people not be able to play with their friends. And also because the VR market is growing, we wanted to get the biggest possible multiplayer pool together. And what we had to do was just come up with some custom art for each of these headsets to sort of complement the processing power of the different GPUs you have. Like the mobile obviously has a lot less kind of
juice
flare going on. It's a little bit of a flatter background, but you can still play with your friends on the Vive and the Rift.
So the forest maybe isn't quite as mystical.
Yeah, it's slightly less mystical. It's actually a cube map on the Gear.
Is it a slider? Is it a mysticism slider? You just draw it down?
We'll have to put that in on the pause menu options.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Just have it. But maybe it doesn't do anything. Maybe it's just there. but no, I know that you are nuts about Ascension because my friend, obviously Mike Gabe here at Penny Arcade, he said that he had gone over to the booth and seen what you guys had put together. And I was like, man, I have to get a hold of them. And so I went to the site, and I mean, you are basically on fire when you're talking about this game. Like I was like, this is a fan. Like this. this person thinks that it's really cool.
I do. It's one of my favorite board games. Like I'm like basically a board game junkie disguised as a video game developer.
Yeah. And
like working on board games, especially like where you can play with other people socially and, you know, talk about your strategies and, you know, kind of call them out on choices that they're making and all of that stuff that you get to do around the table. That's what I want to be doing in video games. But before VR, we didn't really have a great way to do that. So I'm just like, I mean, I could talk your ear off about all this stuff.
This is the whole reason I'm talking to you. I want to have ears talked off. I want them to be abraded as a direct result of the conversation. So I talked to my friend Steve Bowler yesterday, who is making a VR game called Island 359, which could not be more different than Ascension VR. And when I talked to him about multiplayer, he's like, I'm not sure that that's where we're at now in terms of install base and, you know, for the type of game that I want to make, I'm not even sure I can make that game in VR now. And I think that the way that you tried to get around that is basically just like take all comers. Like,
yeah.
you basically get it on every one of those platforms and maybe, you know, amalgamated, maybe all together, there's a case to be made for that social space you want to build.
Right. And you know, the fact is, you know, he does have a point. This is, you know, it's a growing market, and I think that it has come across as sort of artificially isolating because the developers haven't been incentivized to make those multiplayer experiences because already, you know, what is the chance that you and your friends all have VR headsets?
Exactly.
But like what you said with this sort of, you know, take all the comers, you know, like if we can grow the multiplayer feature set and experience with the community and the market and build up those more advanced social features, the friend list, the like, you know, dedicated rooms that you and your friends, you know, meet in,
right,
all of that stuff, as the SDKs for the different platforms come out and roll out with those features, then we'll just grow with the industry and expand this game as it evolves.
But you're basically going at it exactly the opposite way. You're sort of like, if we make these rad experiences that people love and are humanizing of that medium, that it will attract other people.
Yeah, definitely.
It sounds a lot like idealism.
Well, that's indie game development, right?
Now, so I have extra resources here. I've got the rune. Is that what you called the triangle?
Yes, the runes.
Yeah, I got the runes and I have the two attack, but there's nothing I can purchase with these currently
you can get the cultist to the top array.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, and it's got a little red glow to kind of give you that cheat sort of, hey, pick me, to let you know you can afford it.
Got it. I played it a long time ago. I played an extra set, and then I played the iOS version like all other conscious beings. But I have gotten away from Ascension for a while, and it's actually the VR thing that sort of got me looking back at it.
Yeah, I mean, there's a zillion great board games out there, and I want all of them in VR so that I can play with people that live really far away. My sister's in South Carolina.
Oh.
I would love to just be able to like sit down in the evening, chat about our day over a board game together, and of course, it doesn't have to be Ascension. But Ascension made a ton of sense for our team because it has this, you know, this duality of like replayability but also approachability. Like it's a really quick game to kind of pick up and get into. There's just two currencies, you're just acquiring more things, and so I think there are a lot of other board games that take a lot more to get into, and when VR is so new to so many people, we just didn't want to throw everything in the kitchen sink at them, so this was just like this total sweet spot for game design.
I knew some people that were making games. Remember like when Xbox Live was the thing? And like there was that huge like gold rush for board games on Xbox Live?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they had a really great version of Catan, but they had another great version of Carcassonne on there. And like, I vastly prefer digital versions of Carcassonne because then a computer can calculate the farms. Like that's, for me, like that's the sweet spot. So maybe I don't actually like Carcassonne. I need to entertain that possibility. But I remember when he was talking about like bidding for these licenses, he's like, well, there's a lot of games that I like that I think are great games, but I don't think that they're a good match for this, for where I want to make this game. So what do you think, you want to just scoop up all the board games, but where do you want to go from here?
Well, I mean, first step first is just all the expansions that we want to do. And
let's Ascension, I can tell the enthusiasm is there. I expect to see lots more of that stuff. But like outside of the Ascension, or do you think that deck building specifically, because it has the aspects like the physicality of the collection of the cards and things like that, like do you think it's an especially good match?
Well, I mean, you know, since I'm an idealist and since I'm an indie game developer, like I feel like the thing that I really want to do is have something like, I don't know if you guys have been up to Card Kingdom or like—
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like any of those places where you can just go there with your friends. You don't necessarily have to have a game in mind. You just go and like figure out, you know, what do we all want to play today? And you could be together making that decision socially. And then just pick out the game that you want to play and sit down and play it. And what I would like in VR is to have that. And so I'm working on making that, you know, one game at a time, hopefully, so that I can just like go and hang out and play all my favorite games and keep adding more and create an ecosystem, you know, ideally would be like the dream. And, you know, we'll see how far it goes. But I think there is, so you were mentioning like kind of the laziness with Carcassonne and counting the victory points off the farmers, like
yeah. I mean, I know people that don't like to like that are dissatisfied with. They don't even like to reshuffle their deck in a deck building game, right?
No, me neither. I literally before I made this, I bought an automatic card shuffler.
Oh, which, like a Vegas style shuffler.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
I had like these like grand visions that I was just gonna put all my cards in and like hit a button and it was gonna go and it was gonna be this amazing thing.
Does it not work that way?
No, not at all. It's like you put all your cards in and then you hit the button and hopefully it doesn't screw them all up. And then you have to, and then it only really does one shuffle. And you know, your cards have to be like super clean. So don't put any games in there that you've already played in order to get the like, you know, one-to-one shuffling. but I'm the kind of gamer who, like you have probably picked up on, I get kind of obsessive about a game and I will buy every expansion. I'll get super into it. And what you end up having is a ton of boxes, like in your living room, you'll just have all these boxes, all these pieces. And the barrier to entry to just playing a game, I feel like it gets so high because you want to play with all the content that you've purchased, you've invested in.
Well, you never want to feel like you have half of the game. Yeah, yeah, totally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So like that's with the digital stuff, and it doesn't have to be VR, honestly. Like the digital stuff solves that like kind of like busy work, physicality stuff. And then the VR just gives mostly like the social and the cool, like you're in a cool forest and you're the characters, but mostly it's the social stuff.
Let's see. Do you wanna tell me about the Burrower Mark III? Is this a good burrower? Like how do we feel Mark II? How do we feel about this burrower?
Mark II. Well, maybe
These are constructs. These go in the construct bay.
Yes, the construct bay.
I'm sold. I'm using it. I'm using the construct bay from here on out.
Yeah. So if you're not familiar with Ascension, there are three types of cards. There are monsters, which you kill and you get the reward immediately for them. And then there are heroes and constructs, at least in the base set. And heroes and constructs both go into your discard pile after you acquire them. But the cool thing about a hero is its effect takes place immediately when you play it. The even cooler thing about a construct is that when you play it, it goes into this persistent area. I'm calling it the Construct Bay. I'm sure that's not the official name. And it persists over turns. So unless another player destroys it, you get this special effect every single turn, which can give you a really awesome opportunity to build up a huge engine and get tons of runes and just kind of take it away.
Yeah, I remember it being gross. I remember I had some specific combination of them. So I get obsessed with games also, but the thing that I like about games is sort of getting into a like an intuitive state with them. So I'm not like, I don't think that I'm hardcore in the way that you are. I sort of just like to sort of float around in the system. Like, I like to sightsee game systems. So I can never, I flip from game to game, really. Mm-hmm. Let's see. It seems like a good shaman.
Yeah, the nice thing about the art that they did in these games is you just really get to know it. So at some point you stop, you know, just like magic, you start knowing, okay, here's the artwork that represents these mechanics, and you don't have to read the cards anymore.
Yeah, that's completely true. Like in all the versions of Magic the Gathering, all the digital ones, like eventually, and especially once you've sort of, you know, theoretically, once you've built that deck personally, you know, you have some, you know, some familiarity with that stuff.
Right. Yeah, we're thinking about doing some different stuff to, like, you know, to handle some of the legibility tensions that there are in VR, and like just have like the text pop out,
So treat them less like a literal card.
Yeah, yeah, like break it down into the elements that you might, you know, really care about. And so, you know, we're experimenting with that. The nice thing is that because there's such a long ramp of expansions, we can kind of like fiddle with the different UX
ideas
that we have along the way. And also learn from the community, because, you know, like people are posting on Reddit, they're posting on Facebook and Twitter, like their feedback, and we can kind of just treat it, even though it's launched, we can treat it like early access, or we can treat it like a beta in some ways and like keep on evolving the.
Well, yeah, it can be, it can live basically, right?
Yeah.
So the cultist is, he's like a free, he's like a VP that you can just snatch.
Yeah, the cultist, the mystic, and the heavy are these static piles always there at the top. So if you can't afford anything in the center row, or you don't like anything in the center row, you can always resort to those cards. But I think they tend to be like a slightly penalty, like
they're,
I mean,
not optimal.
Penalty, but they're not optimal, exactly.
Yeah.
And really, people tend to like seem to want to go for those constructs quite a bit. At least I do. Everyone has different strategies. Like that's the cool thing about playing online with people, is like you can hear them think through.
Oh yeah, yeah. You can see some. And so you got some features in here that we aren't using currently. But if that was you, across the way from me there, there's animations and lip syncing that are based on the person with the HMD?
Right. So we have the system of virtual puppeteering that Patrick Benjamin, our animator, you know, crazy genius guy on our team, did, which is basically taking your accelerometer and data and your positional data, depending on the headset, and really informing your avatar's animations based on that. And it's not just this cool tech trick. Like, the thing that it really does for you is it really shows where your opponent is focused. Like, you can really see which cards they're looking at, especially if you kind of pop over their shoulder. Like, you can hit the zoom button above your opponent's name and pop over the shoulder. And
oh,
as they're
wicked.
Playing, you can really see where they're attending. And so, like, if they're talking about making a decision between two cards and you're watching them kind of leaning between those cards, it's much more like if you were playing around a table with them in the same room. And I think that fosters a lot of patience when you can kind of like be there with someone making those decisions, even if they're not necessarily talking. Just that animation, sort of like nonverbal communication, comes across. And and then we also complement that with like lip sync. So when they're talking, their mouth is actually, their avatar mouth is moving. But the avatars right now are based on the heroes from this set. So there's the Flytrap Witch, the Demon Slayer, and the Arhat Templar that you can choose from. And we want to do more. And there's spatialized chat too. So if you have like a 4-player game and the people who are next to you, like you can hear them in space, like as if they were really in this arrangement of four people.
Oh, really? So the voices are actually coming like directionally over?
Yeah, yeah. The more in VR that we could do to sort of like support what your vestibular system is getting, like, you know, visually, when you move your head, the camera moves, and auditorily, when you move your head, the sound, you know, the balance between the stereo sound, like kind of complements the orientation of your head, the more
completely
comfortable experience you're gonna have.
Yeah. It's all those points of reference. So I've had conversations about this stuff with a few people now, and it just seems like the more you can, the more that you don't diverge from the perception, the better.
Yeah, that's true.
When you can.
Yeah. And there's things that, like, I mean, and there's places where it matters and places it doesn't. So, like, for example, you know, your perception of where you're sitting in a room right now being really different from this forest doesn't matter.
No, right? No, that's okay. Like, that's our brains are fine with that for some reason.
It's like the stuff that's in motion. It's like the stuff that, like, has, like, that time, that, like, temporal axis. That stuff is where I think you want to be the most careful.
See, now, would I be correct in assuming that you like this Snapdragon card?
I do like it.
Yeah, because this is the sort of construct that sets up the engine combos, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I tend to be a little bit like I always want the game to last forever. So sometimes
yeah,
I will avoid
exactly.
cards that give me direct victory points, because I just like want to, get to like that perfect place where I have like acquired.
Well, no, exactly. It's like, what's the game about, right?
Yeah.
Is it about buying cards?
Yeah. Right?
That's what we want. It's sort of like, I mean, I'm that way when I play a real-time strategy game. Like, all I want to do in a real-time strategy game is see like the biggest, craziest shit. But everybody wants to win the game. Right? They never want to see the you know, the Star Destroyer come out.
Right. No, I'm with you. Like, maybe it's a coping strategy for not winning, but I'm like, oh, I
listen, I would not say that of you, but I would definitely say that that's me. Like,
that
I want to collab. It's like, in my mind, I'm collaborating with the opponent on the perfect game, and maybe that's not what games are about.
No, I totally do that. Like, if I play against the AI, I'll do this thing where I won't kill cultists ever. And it's stupid, but it's like, for me, like, winning the fastest against the AI is not, like, my goal.
You'd probably know what the AI is bad at, too.
Yeah, yeah. So right now, we just have some simple logic for the AI, but we're looking into doing a neural network so that the AI is actually, like, training and learning every time it's playing a game.
Oh,
and
wow.
And we can even, like, train the AIs against each other, and we're sort of working on some of that stuff in some of our other games that we're working on, and we might translate the tech over here, too.
That seems, as a layman, that seems really cool to me. Is that a normal way to program game AIs?
I don't know if it's normal. I'm not like an AI expert by any means. But
me either.
I think that sometimes you run into performance issues. So
I think
there's like a trade-off, because you can get into these crazy branching trees of like decisions that can just take forever. So actually probably people tend to just do a more straight conditional logic, but I don't know.
See, hang on a second. I'm dumb. All right, there we go.
I like the neural network stuff because you'll start seeing strategies that you're like, what?
No, weird you know? Stuff, right?
Yeah.
Weird stuff. I was reading an article about how they had finally taught a computer to play Go.
Yeah.
And like one of the best Go players in the world had what was functionally speaking an aesthetic appreciation of what the computer had done. Like, it had made a move that he described as beautiful. And I was just like, that, I don't know, that seemed like we'd turned a corner somewhere. Like, that seemed like an important piece of word choice there.
Hmm. Yeah, I think, I mean, it makes sense because, well, I don't know if this applies for like the world's best Go player, but like we're so social and we're so like mimicking that, like, you know, usually we're drawing our decisions on what we've seen other people do. And if a computer is gonna, I imagine like that beautiful turn was probably something that was just so outside the realm of,
exactly.
I wasn't there, but I'm imagining it's probably outside of the realm of like what would be a typically sound move by humans.
Yeah, but still functional and effective.
Mm-hmm.
It's just something that for whatever reason, you know, we wouldn't have cooked up.
Mm-hmm.
So is there a point in the auction section here in the middle where you've ground through most of the creatures? Have I gone the wrong way here with these attack points?
You know, it's random. The deck gets shuffled, so I don't know. So, you know, it depends game by game. Like, if you're going to get a lot more military targets towards the end or the beginning, I typically go under military, and that tends to screw me. So,
well, yeah. let me I'll make sure you can get screwed the other way too. that's what's happening now. Maybe the rule is that whatever you have the most of, you're the least able to use. Maybe it's actually like that instead.
We totally do that. We'll just like optimize for least fun.
There's a system. So when it comes to the social aspects, sometimes when in the tabletop space, sometimes what people do is they make a shared play area. Like in VR, where you can play multiple different types of games, like miniature games, or what do you think of that solution?
You know, I'm open to it. I think it depends. Like, you know, with these games, they're not my games. I'm working with IPs from existing board game people, and you know, I'm really going to find out how much they want to intermingle their IP with someone else's IP that may be seen as competitive or something like that. So,
I guess trying to be Switzerland in that situation might be kind of a tough play.
Yeah. And so what I'm seeing with what you've said is a lot of times these are unlicensed. And so
user-generated
content is a little bit more Wild West, make what you want, because really who's going to sue you? But, you know, working with IP, that's not as much the case, so.
No, it's true. Well, hey, thank you very much for coming on and revealing all about Ascension VR. When you get another expansion for Ascension VR going, can I give you a call back? And hopefully by that time, I'll have put some skills together.
Yeah, I love that.
Awesome. Nice job. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
See ya.
Bye.